Yep. Good morning, everyone. And first of all, thank you, Cronin, for getting my name right. You know, I think you mentioned I'm originally from Portugal. If for some reason people have a problem with my name, I get Pablo a lot. I get Paulo with a no. I get Paula. People rely too much on spell check. And the last conference I was at, I was introduced as Paulo. Was going well. Elves. You know, I'm not a big guy, but calling me an elf is a little bit harsh, if you don't mind. But I've come prepared. I have learned when in Ireland, do as the Irish do. And later on, if you find Paul easier, I'm happy to roll with it. No problem at all there. Anyway, I digress. I want to talk to you about evolution. And I started this talk with a video which we produced to celebrate 100 years as a company, which we celebrated in 2016. So as Ireland was celebrating 100 years since the Easter Rising, we were celebrating 100 years since BMW was established as a company. And sometimes it's easy. You can see on the screen there, the first, you could call the first BMW was a Dixie. And for the ones of you that know about cars, it looks like a bit like an Austin 7. That's because it was a bloody Austin 7, which we're producing under license. And on the right, you see the BMW i8. So I've got those two cars to symbolize evolution. And sometimes it's easy for us to think that we've come a long way. Let me argue that we fundamentally haven't. The car is still basically where it was all that time ago. You know, steering wheel, four wheels, very little has changed. In my own lifetime, that's me as a baby on my father's car on 1974, 75, and by the way, it's an NSU Prince, which later became part of Audi. And I know what you're thinking. Admittedly, quite an ugly baby, very chubby. I first used this slide about 6 months ago, and my wife just caught a glimpse of it on my screen, on my laptop, and she said, "Who the hell is that ugly baby?" Very offensive. But it was even more tragic because she was then expecting our first child, and I could swear that we're about to witness the first baby ever to be born ugly, according to his own mother. So I was praying that he'll get at least, you know, mummy's looks and daddy's brains to get something of me. Anyway, that was 6 months ago. Baby was born, you'll be pleased to know, healthy. And they still look all the same to me, if I'm honest. All babies are the same. But I'm told by people that know that he's at least an average-looking baby. There is baby Oscar Rupert. Anyway, I digress yet again. I'm here to talk about evolution. And evolution is a challenging concept because it tends to be exponential. And that gives us two very uncomfortable, very annoying challenges. The first one is, if you don't like change, life is quite a dark place to be. Because things tend to change, and not just they continue to change, but they change faster. Also the concept that, you know, today is the slowest rate of change you will see for the rest of your life. Quite scary, isn't it? Then the second challenge, and it's probably more relevant in a conference called Predict, is that it is bloody hard to predict the future, because our brains tend to be much more comfortable with linear concepts than exponential. We just can't use our own experience that we've acquired over a lifetime, and sometimes as the older generation, I'm starting to jump into that camp, we think we've got the experience, so we know more. We know bugger all, because we cannot use our experience to help us predict the future. We just can't. So actually, a younger person may be better prepared to understand what's coming than indeed a more senior one. I often do some school talks and so on. I talk to kids about engineering and careers and so on. And I compiled this slide with gadgets that formed my upbringing, my growing up years. And the stuff there that unfortunately has been resigned to scrap, he pretty much all of it. Like I said, that IBM computer, my dad used to work with those. My dad still worked with punctured cards there. You can see here on the left. My first computer ever, the PC, kind of ZX Spectrum. You can see mixtapes and Tom and Jerry and the Walkman. All this stuff I thought, this is so cool. It's my first mobile phone there. But in reality, this is now well in the past, and as I said, in the scrap heap. And I use it here as a symbol as well that if you're not careful enough, despite, you know, the size we have as a company, and I refer to BMW as well, the future may not be as certain as we think it might be. So what is the future going to look like? Well, as part of our celebration of our 100 years, of course we kind of give each other a hug and say, isn't it great? We are one of the few companies that can get to 100 years. But more importantly, what does the next 100 years going to look like? So as part of our celebrations, we unveiled four concept vehicles that symbolize where we think we're going to go. What you can see here on the screen is the BMW Vision X100. It's a thorough BMW, a car that will allow you the pleasure of driving that our customers really value, but also the ability to be driven in the car in autonomous mode if you so wish. We unveiled the Mini Vision X100, a car that is a nod towards shared mobility. So imagine you can drive from here to Dublin Airport in your Mini with your temperature settings and your colors and your radio station and everything else. You fly from Dublin to London, you get there, and your Mini comes to collect you, recognizes you, and changes its configuration to exactly the same Mini you left behind. So that means shared mobility doesn't need to be kind of innocuous. You're not going to be in somebody else's car. It can still be your car, even though it's a totally different machine. The Rolls-Royce Vision X100, the car is all about opulence and the comfort of the customers, as you can imagine. Not even the possibility to drive it. It's going to be a fully autonomous car because we expect that's what the Rolls-Royce customer would want. And the Motorrad Vision X100, a motorbike that is so safe that you don't need the helmet. It will project augmented reality information about the road condition, and a bike that keeps itself upright at all times through gyroscopic effect. Now, these were concept cars, clearly, but they symbolize very strongly where we think the development of mobility is going to go. And I'm going to talk to you about these four themes that shape mobility, not just for us, but pretty much the whole of the automotive industry is moving that direction. The first theme is one of electrification. You would have seen outside quite a few of the cars in our range, from a BMW 530e, a car that is a plug-in hybrid. I think Cronin mentioned the BMW i3, a fully electric car. We see very clearly electrification is going to feature as the near to the long-term future. And we started back in 2012. That's what you can see there, the BMW i3, the BMW i8 as well, which is a very progressive sports car as a plug-in hybrid. And this is important not just because, of course, we talk about the beauty or the advantage of electric mobility for having zero CO2 at the tailpipe, so there's no emissions, but we've gone further and we looked at the whole production process and we are using a lot less power, less emissions, a much smaller carbon footprint right from the beginning, right from production. We've earned the Dow Jones Sustainability Index for the last 10 years and is pretty much on the back of the focus we are putting on sustainability. So compared to a conventional small car, if you look at the i3, is about 50% of the carbon footprint in production, let alone the fact that there's no CO2 thereafter when you're driving the vehicle. I was recently at the IAA in Frankfurt, and it's clear that pretty much every brand, they are rushing, they kind of elbows out, getting to the nearest socket to plug their cars. You know, everyone is really rushing towards that electrification of the mobility. And that's just not a professionally taken shot. I took that in my own camera. That was our press conference. And we've got nine models already, including electric scooter, you can see on the screen, a mini plug-in hybrid as well. So nine models that are on the road today. And I really encourage you, I think in all your packs, you got a voucher for a Go Car. It's a great opportunity to try for yourselves an electric car. I highly recommend that. So up until now, when I talk about the way mobility is developing, it's been very much about engineering, you know, harnessing power, harnessing electricity into electronics. But now it becomes about harnessing the power of data as well, because electrification is still about engineering and playing with technology. But from now on, it's about data. I talk about shared mobility. We have something you call Drive Now. It's really a shared mobility concept. We've got it running on, it's actually 13 cities since I put a slide together. We've added Milan and Brussels as well. Over 810,000 customers and growing. People that are using this concept of shared mobility. We expect the younger generations, I can see a lot here today, they don't want the hassle of owning a car. They want to use it as and when they need it and leave it back so somebody else to worry about the tires and the maintenance and the insurance and all that kind of stuff. Also, when you look at the growth for us as a company, if you imagine this very simple diagram, we've got business potential on the y-axis and time on the x-axis. We've gone from a very much an owning economy, which I put Ireland very firmly in that. We're starting to see a bit of finance economy growing, where people are actually being more comfortable with the PCP, you know, the leasing model of car ownership. And we expect in the future the potential for growth is on demand. You know, I think the mobile phone is a bit of a cliche talking about how it has changed the way we look at owning stuff, but it's very true. No one would go and buy an expensive handset and then look to maintain it or replace it. You pay 50 quid a month and off you go. That's your mobile needs catered for. We expect the same is going to happen with car ownership. And the vouchers I mentioned in your pack are for Go Car. It's kind of a car sharing scheme living in Dublin. We don't have Drive Now in Dublin at the moment. The next key theme is one of connectivity. We're all obsessed with data and everything at our fingertips. You can see on the left there are quite a few of the applications. Drive Now, I've mentioned, looking at Park Now, parking availability is served to you so you know exactly where the parking spot is waiting. Charge Now, looking at wherever you are in the world, having a network of kind of charging that you can access very easily and pay for very easily. And BMW Connected app, which we are growing, and really we're heading towards this open mobility cloud where everything from your favorite coffee shop to the weather conditions and the traffic jam and the need to be at 9 o'clock in a certain place is all brought to you into your device from the moment you're in bed, where you get a warning saying, actually, there's been a crash, you probably should get out of bed now if you want to be at 9 o'clock in the RDS in Dublin. That's where clearly the kind of mobility offer is going. And I will finish with the concept of automation. Everyone is obsessed with when is a driverless car coming. It was great to see John actually made a nod towards the Google car you mentioned. And clearly, it's coming. It's kind of already here to some extent. This is the ingredients inside the latest BMW 5 Series and 7 Series with driving assistant, as we call it. There's a lot of technology already in the car to actually allow it to constantly survey the surrounding. And we are already, the way we look at the journey towards autonomous cars is in these five steps. You can see level zero being just about the human interface, perhaps my dad's NSU Prince, as you saw earlier. Feet off with introduction of active cruise control that the car brakes and accelerates for you based on the surroundings. We are already at the hands-off stage. So the latest BMW 5 Series, and of course other manufacturers that do it as well. allow you to actually have hands off for a short period of time at this stage, because it's clear for legal reasons the driver is still fully in control, but you can already let go of the steering wheel on the motorway and the car will carry on steering, braking, accelerating to keep you safe and on the move. The next stage is one of eyes off. For longer periods of time, you can actually go on your emails, iPads, and so on. Mind off allows you to sleep in the car, potentially, take a good nap, and the car will warn you if it needs your help, to eventually, and I'm hoping that's the case by the time my son goes to rugby training, because I don't want to have to drive him to the training on a Sunday morning and stand by the lines in a freezing cold. I can get him in a pod, he'll be driven there and back without me having to get out of bed. Now, this video will be able to explain those stages much quicker than I could.
The BMW Group is implementing fully autonomous driving over 5 levels of development. In the process, the responsibility for driving the car will shift from the person at the wheel to the car itself. Today, the second level has already been reached. Here, the driver is aided by assistance systems and can remove their hands from the steering wheel for brief periods. At the third level, they will sometimes be able to completely turn their attention away from driving, but must be able to step in again at short notice. Once level 4 is reached, the driver might even be able to sleep. They must, however, still be basically fit to drive in case they have to take over control of the car for specific sections of the journey. It is at the final level of development that cars will drive fully autonomously. The driver will become another passenger and won't even have to be able to drive, as the car will assume complete responsibility for the task of driving. At level 2, stereo cameras and radar sensors monitor the immediate surrounding area. Level 3 requires highly advanced sensors, such as laser scanners, ultrasonic sensors, and radar systems, which together produce a 360-degree model of the vehicle's environment. This makes it possible to calculate more complex driving maneuvers. For level 4, fully automated driving from 2021, all sensors and cameras will supply far more precise data, while the real-time data from the area maps provided by HERE will also be factored into the process of computing driving maneuvers. And level 5, the first pilot projects for fully autonomous driving are due to get underway in selected cities from as early as 2020. For the BMW Group, the vision of fully autonomous driving has long since begun.
So you can see how it's developing so fast. Clearly, we're not there yet. I don't think we'll be there just for a little while. You'll see pilots appearing, but there's a lot more work needs to be done on sensor systems. Some of the radar, some of the cameras need to be improved. And you mentioned the power of artificial intelligence. That's going to play a key role. It needs to advance more because we need to be able to say confidently that the car, the machine, is able to handle complex situations in a similar way to a human would do, ideally even safer, because it's constantly creating this digital reality model and will see beyond what we as human beings will be able to see and predict. The big challenge is that big chunk in the middle called regulatory requirements. There's a lot of catching up to do. How will law deal with the fact that are you in control of the car? How will your insurance provider will kind of cover you? Is it you? Is it your fault? Is it the car that took over? There's a lot of work needs to be done there. But I think from a technology perspective, I can assure you by 2021, you'll see the technology ready, pilots running. We probably expect to see fully autonomous pilots running in low-speed areas like cities. Even though they're complex, they're safer, and semi-autonomous or highly autonomous on motorways. John mentioned trucking would be a great example where you can set a, you know, a lorry, a truck from Lisbon to Moscow without really having human intervention or very little human intervention as and when needed. And I use this model here because in the context of the audience I've got in front of me is relevant. Looking at the power of data, you can see how in the future it will only work if the car, if all cars are connected. So actually, the cars way beyond the reach in terms of vision of the car and the sensors, the car knows because the car is getting from other cars information about the situation. So you can have cars transmitting to this mobility cloud, and which turn the reality into a model that every car is tapping into. So a car will know that 300, 500 meters ahead there's an accident, and we automatically reduce speed, whilst we as drivers will be surprised when we get there. You can see how the concept of the machine being safer than us as humans will head towards a much safer driving environment than we see today. And those are the four themes, and with that I conclude my presentation. So you can see a very exciting time for anyone in the industry. And clearly the message, especially in a conference like this, is when I talk about the shift from the power of engineering to the power of harnessing data as a way of shaping the future of mobility. And I'll finish with our, you know, very visual way of representing the way we see the future for all of us.
The future has begun. With mobility that does more than simply transport, it offers new freedom, personally, individually, and full of excitement. Mobility that gives us time for other things, because it's connected, that makes us the ultimate driver, when we want it to, that electrifies. Not only because it's electric, mobility that offers us an exclusive sanctuary and gives luxury a new dimension. That's not only a vehicle, but also a companion. That's always there when we need it and that adapts to us the way we are. That provides us a different kind of safety and a new feeling of freedom. The future has begun with mobility that makes anything possible. BMW Group, the next 100 years.
Thank you.